Okay, hey, so that looked nuts. Hi everyone, welcome to episode one of Organization of American, here's my partner, Will, who gave us our name.
Hey, can you hear me?
Hey, how's it going, Will?
Good morning, Jose.
Hey.
Yeah. We are Organization American States Information Service.
That's what we are.
O.A.S.I.S.
Yep. Yeah, I have COVID, and my eye is twice the size that it should be in some places and smaller in others that are helpful for seeing. So I don't feel great. But we have a great episode for you anyway.
Show us, man, some love in the comments, please.
Yeah. Well, we're also about 15 minutes late. We said we'd be here at 11, and we're not. So people that might have been waiting for us might not be here, but that's okay, because hopefully
it's a nice story. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
They'll come back, and hopefully check out the cool, interesting stuff that we're talking about. Because we're not just doing this to do it. We think this is fun and interesting.
Okay, yeah, we're going to get up some slides, I guess.
Yeah, Will, last time we talked about three different topics, right? We talked about the Mexican Revolution.
Yes.
Of 1910 to 1920, which I think is a good place to start our Mexican political, cultural history story, media res. Then you kind of talked about the amazing Filibusteros movement. Well, not so amazing, but amazing.
It's actually pretty horrible.
Yeah.
Horrible movement.
Very terrible. Terrible things you showed me and taught me. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, so this red on this map is where the Filibusteros kind of expanded into Mexico with their local lackeys. The largely Anglo Filibustero movement, kind of working with some real traders to secede from Mexico even before the Civil War, kind of highlighting, you know, that this eventually, I guess, would come back and the southern states would secede.
Bad people. So this is and all these people are just like pro-slavery. That's their thing, right? Like, slavery is holy and amazing, and we got to protect it, kind of deal.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah, I mean,
wow. Pretty messed up.
We talked. William Walker was talking almost sort of a proto-Marxist analysis of the political economy of slavery, and basically saying that slavery could resolve the contradictions of capitalism, which obviously does not. Obviously, you have a lot of revolutionary movements emerging from the so-called enslaved people, so there's lots of contradictions, but they're out in the open maybe more than the contradictions of capitalism. And I guess if you really had a truly psychopathic population, you know, generationally dedicated to oppressing their fellow humans, maybe you could contain the contradictions of slavery for, you know, a 1,000-year Reich or something, but maybe not. Hopefully not.
No, I mean, like, I don't mean to interrupt you, man. I'm sorry, but I mean, that's kind of what we're dealing with. This whole notion that you're supposed to subjugate a class of your fellow human beings to do the menial, horrible labor work in order to streamline the contradictions of any kind of civilized society, right? Like the Aztecs had, you know, regions of indigenous tribes they hunted down and tried to enslave. Like, you know, we've had the whole Atlantic slave trade in the Americas, you know, lasted centuries and normalized this kind of thinking across the oceans, you know, thinking that no matter where you went in the world, you would find this. Today we have prison labor, you know, even us hard leftists, you know, like North Korea runs on a lot of prison labor. America, United States, I think, might have them beat in terms of population that's actually imprisoned. that does menial labor or that kind of manufacturing jobs.
Yeah, but it's truly both sides.
Truly.
Both sides do it.
Well, yeah. Go ahead.
There's a great director, Raoul Peck.
Yeah.
Who actually directed Young Marx, which is kind of like a film I think we should watch someday. He also directed a pretty cool HBO series, Exterminate the Brutes.
I saw that. It was good.
Yeah, very, very informative and creative. I had to watch in a few sittings. Very, very emotional film. Definitely Nelson Balido, and we're going to get into it in a minute, has almost like a direct connection to the filibusteros. So
awful. Do you want me to keep going with the slides?
Yeah, let's keep it. Let's keep moving. Yeah.
You direct me because I'm over here sickly and running.
You're good. Slide. Yeah. So this dude we went over last time, he is like a very articulate advocate for quote unquote social cleansing. That
genocide.
Click through his quotes and stuff. Spanish Civil War guy on the nationalist side, he's saying like, he says you understand all the time.
I'm gonna read this?
Healthier. Yeah, sure. We read it on the last one, but we could read it again and talk about it a little bit.
Because you got to hear his words. I mean, like this is the kind of free speech that I feel some people really want to advocate to bring back. But the arguments that you have with this kind of speech have been had in civil and violent society, you know, throughout the Latin Americas, throughout Spain. That is the history, a modern day history. That's also why I take issue with the streamlining of like the Latin American history with American civil liberties type of posturing. But he says, you know what's wrong with Spain? Modern plumbing. And healthier times, I mean healthier times spiritually, you understand. Plague and pestilence used to slaughter the Spanish masses. Held them down to proper proportions, you understand. Now with modern sewage disposal and the like, they multiply too fast. They're like animals, you understand. And you can't expect them not to be infected with the virus of Bolshevism. After all, rats and lice carry the plague. Now, I hope you understand what we mean by the regeneration of Spain.
You understand.
Yeah, you understand. That's you know, like, I understand the free speech of it all, but, like, you should punch a guy that, like, talks like that, especially if they're in government.
Well, this guy may have self-owned harder than many conservatives. When he freaked out and mistook his kid for a communist and shot him.
Right.
Yeah.
That takes a cake.
But definitely, the kind of free speech we have in the U.S. where I guess like you can get prosecuted for making terrorist threats. You know, like some guy said he was glad a cop died and they locked him up for 8 months and like kept like stringing his bail out and delaying the trial and stuff. So fundamentally, most Americans live in the Hobbesian state of nature where whatever reactionary organization is, you know, decides to get their, put the beam on you, they can just ruin your life. But we have these bourgeois liberties that you could really only defend if you have a ton of money in the first place. And the way they're constructed, I mean, it's just like, I mean, it's not even like, there's a double standard for everything, you know? I mean, it's really just, you know, you can say like, oh, let's go kill all the poor and get a pat on the back and then do it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you can't start a union or whatever.
Well, he's got a machine gun.
What did you say now?
He says to focus on the male population, exterminate a third of the male population of Spain. That will clean up the country and rid us of the proletariat.
Also, this guy drinks too much. Look, he's having another tumbler of brandy.
Right. This is him. Like, this is weird. We're watching his, like, drunken, you know, what's his name? Spencer Richard Spencer YouTube videos from like 100 years ago, but they're just like third person shitpost accounts of him, like his drunken rants on women.
I mean, yeah, this is the kind of stuff Richard Spencer says, like, we got to regenerate. We got to, you know, be vital, vigorous. You know, what's wrong with killing people that threaten our vitality?
Yeah, that's pretty messed up.
So I guess technically he's saying we should kill a third of the male population, mm-hmm. and then you would have, I guess, permission to murder women whenever you want. So I imagine probably even more women would end up being killed, but the way this guy is constructing it, I guess that would be sort of a private venture of, you know, whatever kind of psychopaths survive in this society he's envisioning.
Yeah, for instance, we'll be done with this nonsense of equality for women. I breed horses and animals generally, you understand. I know all about women. You know, right there, that's what's wrong with fascism. They don't know how to be human beings, I think, ultimately.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Yeah.
It's certainly inhumane. It's socialism or barbarism, right?
Now, you're a bit of our Philo Bustedos expert, and I'm going to go to our next slide, keep this going. But
there's more about this guy.
Right.
Just keep it going. Before you go, though, he also said something, which I think we mentioned last time. He said in a quote that the it wasn't just a class war, it was a race war. Mm-hmm. To kill these, and he said there's a master race and a slave race in Spain, and that probably intersected with more of the actual, you know, race as we know it in Spain, because there's a lot of African descended people in Spain, but at the same time, it kind of shows the ideological content of race for the fascists that, like, yeah. I imagine there were, you know, white Spaniards included in the so-called slave race for extermination, you know? So, yeah. It kind of reminds you of Franz Fanon. He said, you know, the colonists and the colonizer, different species, you know, the colonizer is white because he's rich, and he's rich because he's white. Right. So it's a bit like, bit of the Franz Fanon vibes.
Man, I mean, now, is this fair to point out? Because in part of me wanted to do this podcast with you, right? We kept talking about current events and the things that Latin America are going through and how it still ties to now what Europe is going through, too. Like, it seems like the whole fascist, fanatical, like filibustero movement, which was just like, we're going to be eight zealot agents for a slave economy, because that's what organizes the world, and we're going to base it on race, because that's what we understand in Spain, the war that we're fighting against basically other races that are in our land, you know. This stems from the Moorish conquest of the European Iberian Peninsula of parts of Italy and parts of France and Spain. Right? It seems like the whole...
I would say it the other way, that it stems from the Reconquista. This guy on Red Voice News, Marcus Brown, he has a nice article going through the history of the Reconquista and the relationship to the development of capitalism and racial capitalism. We should link to it on our Twitter. Let's put it out there.
Yeah.
But yeah, definitely. I wouldn't blame the Moorish conquest.
No.
Blame the Reconquista.
Yes.
You know, which had a bunch of these almost like Phoenix program style counterinsurgency campaigns.
That's what I was getting at. So yes, the Moorish conquest of the Iberian Peninsula, basically the Reconquest, the reaction to that.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's still this ongoing white supremacist BS that led to Donald Trump, in my opinion. Like, it was like the German Catholic, like, espionage people sending people into Italy and France, and basically deciding that, you know what, the Spanish part is where we can make the the Inquisition for like our most hardcore zealots. And like you said, I do like this like MK Ultra level brainwashing, but like from an old school kind of Catholic Church holy war perspective that never stopped conquering the Americas.
Yeah, critically, during the Reconquista and the Inquisition, they would like, if you got identified as subversive or whatever, whether it meant, you know, you were the wrong religion or whatever, you had to make a list of like 100 other subversives. So there is this exponential growth in the violence and the totalitarianism, you know, and this this is something that we kind of see today, you know. It's kind of like the same old, you know.
Yeah, I mean, like, but to that point, like, what would be anti-spiritual, what would be against the Catholic Church, which was kind of like a political hegemonic project in a lot of points of its life, still kind of maybe is, I don't know. It'd be communism. That's also this history, this zealotry towards a racial capitalism to rationalize our world, our planet, is the roots of the anti-communist zealotry that we see in McCarthyism, within the FBIs, within the CIA, within all of those like very hegemonic kind of like power structures that kind of take their root from a lot of this spiritual foundation of the Americas. You know, I think that that's what the ideas of communism ultimately threaten, is this very foundation.
Yeah, I think so.
Some psycho guy shooting his kid kind of foundation stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this, we went through a very dramatic reenactment in the last episode. We won't do that again. But I think there's probably a lot of Protestants in the CIA and FBI and whatever. Yeah, and the filibusteros were largely Protestants in the Southern. I guess some of the Southern slave owners were Catholics. But we should go into Pope Pius the 12th. And the activities of the Catholic Church during the World War II and after, for a future episode. I think that might be worth getting into.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
All right. Do we want to keep talking about this terrible Aguilar man and what he does to his kids?
Yeah, he shot his kids, and then he like shot one because he was like, "Oh, I got this. I can't have a witness." So he probably like killed thousands of people like that, like, oh, shoot them, you know, shoot anybody who happens to be standing around. And I guess it's just a reflex. He got old and kept doing it. Yeah,
this is like in the 70s.
Yeah.
And I just kept chatting on the way to the jailhouse, right? Just like,
oh, it was just a chitter chatting because I don't want to put all that out of my mind.
Yeah, it was very terrible business.
Yeah, this, I mean, that was an Italian accent, but it's you know, it's pretty creepy, man. Kill kids. Spain, just like
Italy.
Charlando.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. There will be blood for oil, naturally.
Yeah, it's at like the top of El Perez's article, right?
All right. In 1980, the U.S. Department of Energy published a paper of the implications on the implications of Mexico's energy resources for U.S. policy in the 1980s and beyond. The authors assessed that Mexico would be one of the world's major sources of oil and natural gas, exceeded only by the U.S., the Soviet Union, Saudi Arabia, Iran, and possibly Iraq and Kuwait, and acknowledged that Mexico's resources were critical for meeting U.S. energy needs. Dun, dun, dun. For the RAND Corporation, Mexico's petroleum and U.S. policy implications for the 1980s, prepared for the U.S. Department of Energy.
Yes,
Richard and Arturo. Huh.
El Perez also got this out in, I think, like Covert Action Quarterly, which is a cool publication.
Covert Action Quarterly?
I think that's the one, yeah.
Neato. We get our Twitter backdrop from that photo there. Oil over Mexico City and the world.
Apparently. And fracking oil, critically.
Critically, right.
And there's some nice quotes from, I want to found this P PDF or whatever.
Yeah.
And they talk about Pemex was created by nationalizing Rockefeller's oil holdings in Mexico.
Right.
And so they kind of, in this article written in 1980, they kind of give his lip service to Mexican sovereignty. But then, yeah, click to the next quote. Is it showing up? Here we go.
Oh, yeah. Fortunately, Mexican nationalism is not written in stone and does not prescribe how Mexico's leaders will respond to new situations. Money. Although the traditional ideals bespeak a closed-minded and intolerant attitude towards U.S.-Mexican relations, wonder where that came from, in practice, they can be adapted to flexible, pragmatic, and innovative interpretations. Flexible, pragmatic, and innovative. Man, that's a lot of bribery talk.
The process of symbolic transformation will take time, I guess, like about 40 years or so. And yeah, maybe having a new party to challenge the pre's one party rule will help create these new situations that you know, lead to oil privatization. And we'll see Cabeza de Vaca played a role in just that.
Yep. But first, we're talking about this man.
Yeah, this guy, I mean, kind of scared to start talking about him, but we're just going to get into it.
This is a very nice man that cares about Texas. That's
yeah, a handsome baby face boy.
Basically, he's not doesn't mean anything. He's let's not show our faces while we talk about him. How about that?
Yeah, yeah, okay, so
that's where we're at with this.
Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, let's go through this slow. I added some new slides, so
okay.
I'd like to hear your thoughts on this.
Yeah, as you can see, Nelson Balido is a perfectly normal guy, hangs out with Ted Cruz,
goes on Fox News. Yeah.
You know, Border and Commerce Security Council president. So that's a non-shady title, and he's got a non-shady suit on.
He's also a general. Wait, let me look up what his exact...
What is he wearing? What?
It's kind of the Rodney Dangerfield outfit.
And you would think, well, he gets bullied by like the U.S. side of the security forces, and then like Mexico side of the security forces is like the cartel. So he's a he fixes their problems, you know.
This Lieutenant one? Commander, U.S. Southern Command. This is this guy's current job.
Southern Command.
Correct. I mean, he's a public affairs commander, but that's like, yeah, yeah. Click this podcast. So he went on this podcast, one of the most recent episodes, like the last two or three episodes. One of them was COVID vaccines, including booster, contain mind control nanotechnology. So this is an ecosystem. This is an unhinged ecosystem that he is thriving in.
Yeah. And we've talked about this and Parasus Network seems to pick up on like Breitbart News is just fueling this insanity with some kind of legitimacy in order to create like this narrative of like these cartel wars that like American LARPers can try to like imagine themselves as Steven Seagal, like going their way through cartel Mexico, just laying waste to bad guys doing all kinds of weird unknown things to America. But
yeah, so here's
capitalism.
I remember, you know, like 10 years ago or so before I was like really aware of the deep politics of this country, you know, but I was hearing about these ranchers were saying, oh, this rancher got murdered by an undocumented immigrant walking across his land. Here's the bloody footsteps leading back to the Mexican border.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. And obviously very psychologically unsettling, as a young person of some Hispanic heritage. But at the same time, you know, it goes back to the filibusteros and all their myths about the Alamo and all that BS.
They created the Alamo stuff?
The Texas Revolution was about preserving slavery. So Santa Anna went on a punitive expedition, I guess, which is not really something that is, I mean, he wasn't like a communist or whatever. I don't support Santa Anna, but, these guys are scumbags.
It's a pretty funny King of the Hill episode about like the real story of the Alamo. I don't know how accurate it is, but Bobby has to put on like a woke play about how like Davy Crockett was a drunk and a pervert, and like the Alamo people weren't heroes. And the whole episode is Hank Hill is like angst, having to like have the myths of his Texas undermined.
Man, real America stuff though. Like for real.
Yeah. But there's a lot of other stuff. Like this guy, Narciso Lopez, like he invaded Cuba multiple times. But yeah, but like he became a martyr. They're like, oh, he got he was like tortured to death or whatever. So look, this is all on his website. It's like, yeah, can you just go back to the first one?
Yeah.
Yeah, Nelson Balado has a lot of juice. Look, you can get your bit accelerate your business. And here's a picture of the border wall. Like, okay. And go through all the ways you can accelerate your business on the border with the Navy contracts, which he's part of.
Wow. Napoleon aircraft carrier. I don't know what kind of security you're...
I mean, accelerate your business at the port if you don't want to accelerate your business on the border.
Yeah.
And it says services, public relations, maritime training, cross-border consulting, government relations, government contracting, product demos, border law enforcement. So this guy has got in his fingers and a lot of pies related to the border business, including these very lucrative. So here, look, this is literally a picture. This white guy with the
sunglasses. Michael Flynn. He looks just like him on the left.
Yeah, I think, I mean, he looks like one of these Enron guys. But look, this is the service you're getting. You get to stand in the shade in the tent and get FaceTime with all the Border Patrol and their weird toys. You give Balido some money, that's what you get.
Yeah. For those of you listening at home, we are a visual podcast. I don't know why we put this on Spotify, but yeah, you need to watch these photos in order to make sense of what we're talking about.
Or just believe us, you know.
Just believe what we're saying. Don't worry.
Or check out the slide, go through it at the same time as you listen on Spotify.
Do your own research. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So these are some of the companies that pay Balido's consulting firm. We have Foxconn on here. We have Motorola. We have KGP Logistics, which I assume is like some kind of military contractor. Fisher Price for some reason.
Train. I have family that works for them. That's messed up.
Mm-hmm. Mossberg, the gun manufacturer. Johnson Controls, I imagine, is related to Johnson & Johnson. Body Worn is like some kind of body camera company, I imagine. But the bunch of solar panels, I guess there's some like stupid woke plan to put solar panels on the border wall.
Awful.
Marmac Wire, I assume that's for like barbed wire. Midwest Textile Company, I wonder how, like, whether that's like a huge company or a small business.
Mm-hmm.
But you can see it's like a bunch of companies, so this is not like a scammer in the fraudulent traditional sense. This is someone with a lot of capitalist power.
Right. He's at the nexus of a lot of people that want this border to be big business, more or less.
Yeah, the border and also getting stuff through the border. He's a port consultant about how to get your stuff through. So I don't think that he's like involved. I mean, I shouldn't even be saying this in the first place, but I don't think he's involved in like, quote unquote, like getting drugs through the border or whatever.
Okay. Well, yeah, it's a little far there.
But he's like, he's involved in getting merchandise through the border. And like one of the things about this guy is one of the things about the shakedowns in the Tamaulipas mafia is like they're not just like selling drugs. They're also just shaking down regular businesses.
Right.
That are and even like people, like non-business people, just buying stuff in America and bringing it to Central America. They're shaking those people down.
Right.
So, I mean, you can imagine that this dude's saying, like, yeah, I'm just going to get your stuff through, like merchandise, well, whatever. I mean, that's a lot of power considering the environment of the how power is expressed in that context, which is like a lot of these Tamaulipas power players, they control cross-border traffic of all kind of merchandise.
I mean, that seems to be what border business is. They created it in Israel with Egypt, but then the control flow of goods, but not of people. So like you create security to control the flow of people, basically stop the flow of people. And that same security then becomes in charge of the control of goods. And you want more goods than people going through your border. And that becomes your business. And, you know, you can make it work. But as we're whole point of this podcast to explore, especially when it comes to Tamaulipas, especially when it comes to the government of Cabeza de Vaca, especially during the cartel wars, which was what was necessary to make this border situation a reality, it takes filibustero amount of genocidal foundational policy to just kill hundreds of thousands of people. Well, tens of thousands. Up to 100,000.
I think it wasn't 100,000 in the Mexican cartel war.
Yeah.
There's another thing, the merchants war, which we kind of touched on in the filibustero segment, but I think we should go into in greater depths, which was a war where Texas merchants invaded the Tejano merchants and some their other, I assume some Mexicans as well, invaded Mexico for the purposes of kidnapping African Americans and also promoting free trade and seizing back stuff they claim was stolen from them. So we should get into the merchant war sometime because it's more of this similar thing. So we're going to get into Nelson Balydos' education, primarily the Citadel. The Citadel is a very weird college that I think I actually heard about in high school in sort of a health class on diversity and inclusion, because they had like a vicious hazing, I don't want to say scandal, like they were viciously hazing all of the, I'll just let you finish.
Sorry, go ahead.
You're good. Health comes first.
So vicious hazing, huh?
Yeah, vicious hazing of like the first women students that I guess they were required to admit women in the 90s. And I think they went along doing it informally excluding women, just de facto excluding women until some women applied to the school with like gender ambiguous names and accidentally got admitted. And then just from day one, they were viciously hazed, and it became a whole national scandal because of the cruelty of it.
Wow.
Just click through here. So the Citadel has a filibustero or an origin in slavery. Yeah. Go ahead. The picture of this guy, what's it say here? It says,
"For few colleges, however, were founded expressly for the purpose of defending and maintaining the institution of slavery. The Citadel, South Carolina's public military college, is one such institution. Since the mid-1960s, the Citadel has regularly made headlines for its reluctance to admit and for its questionable treatment of Black students and women. In the mid-1800s, the Citadel was noted for the vehemence with which its cadets and alumni defended the institution of slavery, a purpose for which the institution, founded as a military college of South Carolina, was created. The Citadel Library website explains the relationship between the fear of slave insurrection and the early history of the institution."
Yeah, this is from somebody's blog. It's their opinion, but I thought it was a pretty concise statement. Probably should link that blog. I think it's called Black on Campus. Yeah, we should definitely actually link them. I think it might be in the notes of this slide.
You can find on our YouTube comments.
Yeah, you can find the slides. Also, you could probably find, we could probably tweet their thing out even.
Yeah.
But this dude's named Denmark Vesey. And he was a Black man who I think bought his freedom. And he was accused of this conspiracy to start a slave revolt.
I think it's pretty ambiguous how much of it was him versus like the white paranoia. There was definitely a whole thing in the courts about how these judges that suspended the Constitution were actually defending liberty and stuff, because you can't have liberty if you've got these slaves uprising and stuff. So, you know, so-called slaves. They killed this guy after railroading him. Maybe he, more power to him if he was going to lead a rebellion.
Cool.
Either way, they wanted to have a militia. Then they realized they had to pay everyone. It's like, oh, we could save money by having this psycho institution of cadets who we brainwash to fight our war for free. And
the Catholic zealots.
So. Yeah, they voted to create a municipal guard. And it doesn't say this is from it's called Black in Charleston or something. It's another blog. It's a pretty good blog. We should like cross promote, you know. If we want to get promoted, we should go out there and promote. But they literally says, I think on the Citadel's website, that it was more, or at least on the Wikipedia page, that it was more expensive to have this municipal guard. So they wanted to have cadets because it was cheaper.
Cool. So they just generally created a culture of slave catching. They could try to prevent any kind of insurrection.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's a real, real creepy culture.
Mm.
Do you want to, if you
wanna are read looking, this?
Yeah, sure, if you want.
The Citadel Military College of South Carolina has its origins that date back to 2022, when Denmark Vesey, a free black man and founding member of Emmanuel AME Church, plotted a slave revolt in Charleston. Before the insurrection could begin, Vesey and his co-conspirators were discovered and publicly hanged. That year, the South Carolina legislature voted to create a municipal guard and arsenal at Marion Square to fortify Charleston against future slave rebellions. In 1842, the legislature established the South Carolina Military Academy with locations in Charleston and Columbia. The first class of Citadel cadets reported to school at Marion Square in 1843. So 21 years after Denmark Vesey was hanged, this college goes up. And then only 30 years later, the Civil War starts? When was the
American Civil War? And this says they're proud to say that their students were there at Fort Sumter, where the first shots were fired in the Civil War.
We got all our kids killed. We're awesome.
If you remember, these first shots were almost like a deep event, because nobody knows who fired the first shot. And it's possible, you know, who knows what they got up to, you know, like maybe these Citadel, I mean, speculating here, maybe these Citadel students went to Fort Sumter to start the Civil War.
Yeah, terrible kids. 1861 to 1865, that was the Civil War. 4 years. Crazy.
Yeah, there's a few more images if you click through this slide.
Sorry.
Is them raising the old stars and bars.
Yep.
They're also really into the Confederate flag, and I think like last year maybe they took it down in some very melodramatic display.
That'd be so weird to be so into both flags. Like, I don't know anyone else that lives their life that much oddly. I have to do everything to worship this flag, but only because I really love this other flag. So it's that's.
I think most of the Confederate flag heads are also into Old Glory.
Right, that's what I mean. It's I don't know. It seems like a lot to me. I could never get into it.
Oh yeah, yeah. So I moved some slides around. It's possible it didn't update yet though. I moved. There's a lot of cult imagery in the
occult, you said?
Yeah, it's a very weird campus, and I decided we're gonna get into racial and sexual abuse of hazing and child sexual abuse even at the Citadel. which is very serious. I don't want to make light of that at all, but I wanted to try to see if you could try to like maybe go out of the presentation view and get the find that occult slide.
Okay, you want me to go to that?
Yeah, yeah. See if you could find it. It has a Pat Conroy novel as the main image.
Okay, because you have a bunch of stuff here from FBI clippings, Citadel cultural abuse, 1 in 5 women.
Don't make fun of my corkboard with the red string.
I mean, this, okay, occult vibes.
Occult. Let's get that one up. And yeah. I can, you know, I don't want to be like ordering you around or whatever. Like, I can put it up if you want.
It's fine. What you call it? Try to make sense of your slides here. There's a lot of photos of just like random dudes.
Yeah, these are the occult vibes. These kind of minarets. This China. Is definitely a Middle Eastern theme for very racist people. Yeah. This giant chessboard, kind of Alice in Wonderland.
Pretty gross.
Obelisks, this gigantic ring here, right?
Yeah.
Which also, there's going to be a gigantic ring. Yeah, check out this dude's.
What's that?
There's going to be a gigantic ring on Texas A&M campus, which is also a really weird school with a military tradition. It's where Nelson Balado went for the George Bush School of Government.
Yeah.
So this dude, he's wearing his school uniform. It's the military uniform. And he's got this crescent up here. It's weird for, you know, I imagine these are like largely white Christians who are very, I mean, I'm not going to assume this guy's racist, but
wow.
The school has a racist history.
Just judging him based on his skin color and career choices and spiritual beliefs, man, it's kind of messed up, bro. But yeah, he's probably racist.
I'm not trying to condemn this person. But this dude went to the school, Pat Conroy. He's a writer who went to the Citadel, and then he wrote a book called The Lords of Discipline.
God.
About the Citadel. And about in the book, there's a secret society that's secretly hazing the students that they've secretly determined to be unworthy in secret meetings. So
wow.
There's definitely some occult vibes. Oh yeah, but then do you mind to go back to the beginning of the Citadel section? So here's a trigger warning.
Okay.
Then this guy in 2015. I guess this is Captain Gino Peluso. So he had a meeting. He's a Navy SEAL. He had a meeting to tell the freshman cadets that there's no more hazing. And that they had better report any hazing until noon. They have until noon the day after they get hazed to report any violations of the hazing code. So definitely they're taking this problem seriously.
Did you wear the code red? Did you wear the code red?
You need men like me.
I want the truth.
You can't handle the truth.
That's what this is.
So this is from their history thing. And yeah, go ahead, click there. This is from an internal history published on the Citadel website.
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying nothing has fundamentally changed.
Wow.
I'm going to do the voice that I imagine for Rod Andrew Jr. If one spends time reading memoirs of former military school alumni or old disciplinary records, one might be struck by how much hasn't changed. 19th century military school cadets delighted in elaborate pranks and harassing underclassmen. And like today's cadets, could be absolutely ingenious in finding brilliant ways to sneak out of and back into the barracks after a lights out. Yes. So this hazing, this harassment of underclassmen, that's like, I guess, celebrated today as a tradition, despite the fact that these two women, Kim Messer and Jeannie Montavious, were sexually harassed and like escalating patterns. And in one of the articles in the Times, it said that there was like freshmen being set on fire at the Citadel.
Wow.
So I don't know if they set the women on fire, but it was bad vibes. And the FBI in the 80s, so 86, Nelson enters the school in 88, Nelson Balydos. He goes from 88 to 90. So maybe he only went for 2 years because he got hazed. He didn't like the culture. He thought it was bad vibes. We don't really know. But the FBI investigated the school for a bunch of students at the peak of their hazing. I guess they dressed up in KKK uniforms and broke into a black cadet's room and burned a paper cross. So,
Jesus.
Pretty bad vibes. This is not cool pranks. No. You know, this is actually like horrifying stuff,
yeah.
Like brainwashing stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Trump, you know, very, very traumatic. It's not cool.
Yeah.
Nelson Balido went here. That doesn't mean, you know, maybe he as a, you know, a Tejano, Mexican American, he was subjected to hazing and left after 2 years. Maybe everybody leaves after two. I don't know how it works.
Yeah. Wow. 1 in 5 women at Citadel reports assault.
Yes. The campus sexual assault is a very serious issue at all colleges, but I imagine this is probably pretty bad at this college with the whole creepy culture.
Well, it stems from that one Aguilar guy's kind of way of thinking. And he said that women that were unfaithful to their husbands should just be shot on the spot and not have to deal with like court systems about marriages. So like, guessing that culture is still kind of prevalent.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's certainly part of the world culture. Silvia Federici wrote a good book, I forget what it's called, but it's about the Middle Ages and how promoting patriarchy and these male privileges of violence against women, private violence, was a way to co-opt some of the peasantry to support the new capitalism. And it definitely seems like these privileges of private abuse are part of the psychological rewards of participating in this Citadel system of fighting for slavery for free, you know?
Yeah. Yes. Which, God, this is some QAnon stuff right here. Yeah, like the rich elite aristocrats would let some of the peasantry participate in their crimes and awful like privileges that they have over society, and they would have some outgroup, whether it was slaves or lowercase or women in general, to bring them part into the fold. That seems like that's kind of what we see repeatedly within the Trump movement. That's that relationship that the normal MAGA chud that, you know, doesn't have any military or police training, but has an AIA, but gets pushed to the front of a Capitol insurgents.
Yes, I'm sure that the Proud Boys from January 6th had a view of some of these QAnon weirdos as being other expendable outgroup.
Yeah.
So there's been at least two, and I didn't do like a deep dive of every single article about the Citadel. I wonder if you could find more sexual abuse accusations at the Citadel. But in 2007, I think that's the right date, the lawyer of one of the abuse survivors wrote this article on their law firm website about the abuse and the cover-up. Apparently Citadel had their own investigation. Yeah, 2007 in-house investigation that they did not go public or to law enforcement with. Then this whole thing blew up. I guess 2011, it all came out publicly. There's lawsuits. And in 2018, there's another Citadel staffer doing sex abuse. And this is at a summer camp that was at the Citadel. This is not the college students' abuse. These are under 18 campers attending summer camp at the Citadel and getting abused by camp counselors. So
God. Yeah, so just culture of abuse beginning to end, huh?
Yeah, and this is Skip Reve. This is the one of the person who's part of the real big sex abuse scandal from 2007. Yeah, these are the occult vibes.
Yikes.
So let's talk George Bush School of Government if you're ready.
Yeah, sure. Of course. That's a good segue.
So this is George H.W. Bush. This is the Pata oil man, you know, schemer in deep politics. I'm going to go ahead and say that he is was the point man in Dallas for the JFK assassination.
Wow. Okay. I didn't say that. It was definitely the mob and not the CIA with George Bush, but
his Andover roommate, George's Andover roommate's uncle, George's de Morenschild, is the only person who knew Kennedy, Oswald, and Bush.
Bad man.
Check out George de Morenschild for more info.
In
The Family of Secrets by Russ Baker.
Okay.
So is this a name for him? I mean, I think it's pretty clear he's the intellectual author of 9/11. His father, Prescott Bush, was the intellectual author of the JFK assassination, I'm going to say, and big-time Nazi collaborator, helping the Brown Brothers Harriman, helping the Nazis squirrel their ill-gotten gains out of Europe as the war was winding down.
Oh, my God. All right. That's a lot of heavy accusations there. I mean, that all tracks, but how did Prescott, Big Papa Bush, not HW, his dad, how did he make his money in World War II? I'm guessing with Nazis, but like, what do they do?
Okay, so there's a dude, Neil Mallon, who's a real deep state figure. He's like, if you go into Family of Secrets, it's like a pretty cool read. Neil Mallon was like this outdoorsman who is also like in the upper echelons of all these investment banks, and apparently he would do stuff like he would come back from a mountaineering trip with like rosy cheeks and walk in the office and there's a waiting room full of candidates for a job and he'd just go, him, hire him, yes, he's a good man, and you know, kind of WASP, real hardcore WASP vibes.
Yeah, I like the cut of his chip.
So Prescott Bush, he had money, I think, from like small businesses and stuff, but he kind of married into this dude Neil Mallon's family. I think it's kind of fair to say. No, he married into Herbert Walker's family. That's why George Herbert Walker Bush, the name Herbert Walker. He married into Herbert Walker's family, and then Neil Mallon was like the best family friend, weird loner, and world traveler, creepy vibes. But he was like the best family friend of Herbert Walker, and then he started hooking up the Bushes.
Yeah. Huh.
So here's the lovely campus, part of Texas A&M.
Okay. Is that that ring you were talking about? I kind of see it.
Yeah, well, there's going to be a giant Texas A&M ring.
Yeah.
Balido did not go to – he just got a graduate certificate, so he didn't, like, really go to, like – I don't know how much research you do for the graduate certificate. We're going to get into the master's program at the Bush School and some of the capstone projects that came out of there.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, let's click.
Graduate certificate.
For that's the giant ring on Texas A&M's. Okay. Hopefully I have the link in the notes for this slide.
You can kind of see it right there. Do you see it by the trees, by the plaza, by the quad? It's like in the middle, but to the left.
Yeah, I think I see it. So the gigantic ring is on the George Bush Graduate School campus.
Huh. Spooky.
Yes. Certainly there's some occult activity, occult vibrations. My third eye is fearful. There's a fear on my third eye. So Balido got a certificate here. I don't know what that means. But if you do the master's program, you can write a capstone project that's kind of like a senior project or a thesis or whatever.
Yeah.
You write it for clients such as U.S. Southcom, where Nelson Balido currently works as a commander, Strat4, private intelligence company, U.S. CENTCOM, USAID, Mexico City office. So you're starting to feel a little tingle.
tingle of some spooky vibes, some spy activity. The Rand Corporation, the FBI, they're hiring George Bush grad school students to write about the evolution of Al-Qaeda, malign foreign influence.
I mean, some of this stuff seems legit, like strengthening municipal security to prevent crime and violence in Mexico. Strengthening municipal security.
Yeah,
but actually, that's exactly what we're.
Yeah, that sounds like there might be a sinister undertone, considering it's coming out of the George Bush
China. School. There's international just relations. China. What's your project, China?
Iran's partnerships with China and Russia.
See, that's something. China's expansionist designs. Okay, I mean they're better than Microsoft's, I guess.
You know what? We probably actually you bring up a good point, which is we probably should look up the text of that capstone about strengthening security, local security in Mexico. But I don't think there's links to the recent projects, possibly for security reasons, but you can read the old projects. And let's click. We're going to show the 2019 projects. If you click. Yeah, so that's like Strat4, Southcom, Atlantic Council, more of these kind of deep politics clients.
Women, peace, and security. It's very general.
Sounds like, well, I think if you open it up, it's going to be about human rights imperialism or something. I opened up a few of these, and some of them, even with like climate change, preventing climate change or whatever, it had a very sinister thesis about like doing imperialism to prevent climate change.
I found my favorite one. I love this. How can government intelligence, law enforcement, and commercial enterprise, because they're included, identify an irrelevant, actionable signal in the overwhelming noise of today's big data collection? That's really good. That's a really good title.
And that dang, just we need to write them to get a copy.
I would just, if I was a judge, just like right away, yep, that one's winning. I haven't seen any of them. That one's good job. You already got me. Like,
I mean, that's kind of the thesis of the O.A.S.I.S, right? Sure. Is government intelligence, law enforcement, and commercial enterprise.
You get an A from us. All right.
Thanks for being you.
Yep.
So this was my favorite. If you click to the next one, this is my favorite capstone project. Mm-hmm. The text is up. You can go and check it out on the George Bush School of Government website. So the CIA hired Kristen Childress, Bethany Cornley, Drew Davis, blah, 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 to talk about the lessons learned from the 9/11 and WMD commissions. And I kind of looked through the executive summary. I didn't read the whole thing, so I may be taking this stuff out of context, but let's look at a few of these lessons that they learned from the 9/11 commission.
Cool. Do you want me to read this? Who people are?
It's up to you. If you want, you can read it if you want.
The goal of the projects, which involvement involved it, no, you're fine. You're right. Okay. So this is, you know, this to determine what steps must be taken.
If you click again, yeah, just click a couple times. It's going to show the whole list of, Never mind. Go back. Sorry. Click forward one. Yeah. So this is saying that they want to take the steps to accurately portray the image of the agency, prevent formation of inaccurate negative impressions of the CIA. So they interviewed commissioners and staff from both the 9/11 Commission and the WMD Commission, former CIA agency. We just call it the agency or the company, actually, more often. It's agency administrators, officers, and analysts. So this shows that the students of the school have a shitload of access. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know if you're like, if you go to the Harvard or Princeton or whatever, maybe you're getting some more prestige, but you're definitely getting a lot of access going to the George Bush School of Government.
Mm-hmm.
And so let's look at some of these recommendations. Yeah. Recommendation one is to do your own investigation first to preempt the public investigation. Recommendation two is to utilize political and organizational context to undermine the official investigation by aggressively making counter recommendations
that may be contrary to the national security of the United States. Wow.
So no, but so they're saying determine the likely consequences of the commission finding and be prepared to aggressively counter recommendations. Yeah, and so if the commission says something that's contrary to national security, you want to undermine that with the public relations campaign.
Yeah.
And of course, you want to inform the commission of the implications for disseminating too much information to the public.
Yeah.
You definitely don't want the public to have too much information.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to, yeah, so you want to be liaising with everyone on the commission one-on-one behind the scenes, letting them know that if they want to appear objective, they better make the CIA look good.
Wow.
And there's some more. This is my favorite one. So strongly recommend to the commission that a significant number of intelligence community veterans, as opposed to political aides, be employed as staff. Because be mindful that experienced intelligence professionals have a better understanding of agency culture and protocol, and may, as a result, help to accelerate and shorten the investigation. So you want to respect the lived experience of these CIA veterans who did 9/11 by making sure that they are also in charge of investigating it.
Yeah.
And yeah, just click one more time. Yeah, you want to accelerate and shorten the investigation. That's the recommendation for how to improve the negative impressions that came out of the 9/11 commission.
So not like the January 6th commission that just got started a year later, but not CIA.
Did you see? Yeah, but so that's like overall for the George Bush School of Government. I think you have a picture of, like, if you open up whatever that women and human rights essay, I mean, the title is sort of probably going to be in contradiction to the content, like strengthening the 9/11 commission, how to cooperate better. That was all about how to cooperate less, you know?
Yeah. Okay.
Did you see the Hamilton song?
I did not. I heard about it, which was upsetting enough, but
I actually went and listened to it, and I was confronted with some evidence for the QAnon conspiracy, which is that Nancy Pelosi introducing Hamilton appeared not to be familiar at all with the musical when I watched it. And
well, she's old and senile and on drugs and drunk all the time, so like,
yeah, but my impression would have been that she goes and sees
high risk life.
I assume she would have seen Hamilton like 20 or 30 times, being
probably has, she just can't remember it, you know.
Maybe I think that this is evidence that she's spending the vast majority of her time in QAnon dungeons, and she doesn't even know who Lin-Manuel Miranda is. And
I think she's just drunk and on drugs all the time, like all of them are.
Well, are those things mutually contradictory, you know?
Yeah, no. I mean, she could be doing all of it. She could be drunk and drugs at the QAnon dungeons, you know, if they're out there, you know. But they're probably just office rooms and like at the Sears Tower building.
God, that's beautiful. That's a beautiful insight, Jose.
No. It
probably is these gross conference rooms.
Yeah, it's just an awful dark reflection of the world that we live in, dude.
With the thing you drag across that barrier to subdivide it.
Let's talk about this awful photo we're watching.
Excuse me. So here's your boy. Oh yeah, let me get my coffee too. Just one sec.
I'm sorry.
I'm just getting I'm refreshing my coffee real quick.
All right, we're about to get into it, y'all. This is it. This is the big fish. This is why we're both struggle sessioning through this. This guy's probably going to get away with everything he's done, just like everyone else that's helped the American government, the Bushes and the Clintons, do all the things that they needed to do to make America function. But that's okay. You know, I am trying not to have personal beef or animosity with the problematic figures in history that I cohabitate this planet with, because they don't know me and I don't know them and I don't know their story. But suffice it to say, though, this man in the middle, the governor of Tamaulipas, is at the focal point of all of this history that we've been talking about in this region. of basically racial and patriarchal dominance over the region in the spirit of the Catholic conquest over these lands. You know, I don't know if he meant to do all that stuff, but that's definitely what he's doing now.
Rosé. Broseph. All right, got my coffee now. Just waiting for Jose to come back.
Not there yet.
No, I'm here. I'm here. No, I was on the phone. Wait, you want to watch the Nancy Pelosi's introduction to the.
Sure. You want to share your screen?
Yeah. Let me share this real quick.
So I didn't really care for Hamilton. I got to be honest. It was heavily recommended to me by a friend that I respect and I enjoy sparring or just discussing, you know, different perspectives and things. I wanted to like Hamilton, not a fan, but I like what's his name, dude's name,
Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Yeah, I get it's hard to hate him.
Yeah, I mean, I don't necessarily have a problem with Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Whoa, that person.
I'm not really actually that familiar with his work outside of Hamilton.
He did that little monkey cartoon on Netflix. It was really cute.
Okay, yeah, so this is the evidence. This is the QAnon evidence. I have it queued up, ready to play. Okay. Yeah, my confession is that originally I was not into Hamilton, but my partner actually liked Hamilton, and then I got super into Hamilton for a time. And neither of us are into Hamilton any longer. We can see some real problematic aspects to it, to say the least.
I see.
But I am going to confess, I actually applied for the lottery to get Hamilton tickets in New York. I entered repeatedly because my partner was, it was all for love though. So, you know, what can I say?
Yeah.
Got it. All right. So let's watch this real quick.
We're privileged to have.
Oh, can you hear the sound?
Yes.
Okay.
A contribution from one of the great creative talents of our time, Lin-Manuel and his father, and the Hamilton singers, whom we'll hear from, said that they were all very honored to be asked to participate today. I call your attention.
Okay, so and the Hamilton singers.
New energy to face the tasks ahead of us, and a renewed promise to strengthen the foundations of our democracy. We are all stewards of the American experiment, working to pass down to our children and our grandchildren a more perfect union that treats all its citizens with fairness and equity. We should never take our rights and liberties for granted, and we must remain committed to finding a way forward together. That's what I wrote about in the song Dear Theodosia from Hamilton. I believe no challenge is worth abandoning our efforts to unite as Americans. We'll keep working, generation after generation, until we reach that someday.
So they do it kind of like this, like a Zoom call of all the singers. I don't know if we need to watch the whole thing.
Okay.
We can watch it all if you want, but
I mean, I think it would have made for a better piece for the people at home. But
okay, let's do it.
It might get taken down YouTube if we do. I don't know.
Oh, I don't even. I mean, yeah, maybe. You haven't seen it, so you might as well watch it. Okay, but first, forensic dissection. What? I don't think Lin-Manuel's father was involved in Hamilton, and Nancy Pelosi's like, yeah, Lin-Manuel and his father, something. They like cut. There's a clear cut from when she's talking. Then she's like, yeah, and the Hamilton singers. Like it seems like she's never heard of Hamilton at all. Which
she's probably just on drugs, man. But like, was she just talking about his father also being part of the American dream? Because that's all that she probably knows about immigrant life. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe that's, yeah, I guess let's all just rationalize away Nancy Pelosi's disturbing behavior.
What? She's on, what you call it, child, you know, brain dead drugs, and is a drunken robot, you know, that like votes to have millions of children dead and killed all the time. Like, yeah, and that's not rationalizing. That's who we know.
Yeah. Yeah. When someone tells you who they are, believe them.
Okay, well, maybe that was the QAnon giveaway, and I'm just not appreciating it.
It's all good.
I'm sorry.
You're good. Let's watch the rest of it.
Let's talk about... Oh, fine. Let's watch the rest of it.
It's pretty awkward, though. Say to you, you have my
love, you have your mother's name. When you came into the world, you... This is so awkward. You broke my heart.
Came of age with our young nation. Day to you. Domestic life was never quite my style when you smiled. This guy's real creepy. You knocked me out, I fall apart, and I thought I was so smart. You will come of age with our young nation. We'll bleed and fight for you. We'll make it right for you. I don't know. I mean, I feel bad calling this guy creepy, like creepy or like under duress.
Yeah, they look like they're singing as the Titanic for democracy, as the Titanic is like sinking. Yeah, you'll blow us all away
someday. Yeah, I mean, the story of Hamilton, I guess, is Lin-Manuel Miranda read a book about Alexander Hamilton, and then he was kind of like, wow, this guy was really grinding, and he was an immigrant. He really like hustled his way to the top, you know. So
that was during Occupy Wall Street and like the Black Lives Matter movement.
Yeah, when this dude started the Fed, we need to audit the Fed. There's, but anyway, like, yeah, I can't really hate on Lin-Manuel Miranda for that, I guess. Like, that's cool, grinding, hustling, making money. That's why I'm here. But, son of a whore and a Scotsman.
God. Yeah, people just wanted Medicare for all. Nancy Pelosi is like, nope. What I got, fam. What I got, fam.
She gets all the medicine she needs.
Yeah. I feel like Grandma Pelosi.
Drank and Zans and stuff.
Yeah, I know you wanted health care, but...
But I feel like... Like a less sinister Democrat would get Zanned out and go see Hamilton.
Yes.
Yeah, some of these folks don't look happy to be here.
Oh, they're reading.
Some of them are really good actors, though. There's a cool one of the Nancy Pelosi's back up. Wow, who are those people?
Okay.
Okay. Well, anyway.
Thanks for watching our YouTube channel. Follow today's talk.
Get away. All right. So that was that was to demonstrate.
The evidence is there, Jose. Open your eyes.
Right. Well, that's the kind of person that Nancy Pelosi is. So a bad one. And she's friends with this guy. So we can surmise that he's not a healthy person either.
Wait, are there pictures of her with Bali though?
With Cabeza de Vaca.
Cabeza de... Wow. What's shared? Let's get that up. Nelson.
Oh, yeah. Let me... Search it. Yeah. Let me see this.
All right, we're gonna race. I'm searching for it. He's gonna get it first.
Oh, Bernie tweeted something. Gotta retweet it. Okay.
You ever heard about the tortoise and the hare? The hare got distracted. Lost a big race.
Tweeting Bernie Sanders.
Something like that.
And then there's also Lori Lightfoot.
Oh, I got distracted though. Hold on here. Lori Lightfoot in Bali though?
No, her just being a punk about COVID. I got it. Aha.
All right, I'll stop sharing. All right, let's see it.
So it's just the one photo that I keep finding, but you know, they're chilling.
Cabeza de Vaca. Yeah, but you know, she's got to know. I mean, she's got the, so she's got the plug. Whatever kind
plug,
of,
bro.
Yeah.
I mean, the way I figure it is that over in California, you got a different cartel. You got the Sinaloa cartel. And Tamaulipas, being the Gulf of Mexico, primarily is run by the Gulf cartel. And in my eyes, the Gulf cartel is the, I mean, all of them have touched on this filibustero history. And I mean, cartels in general are not good organizations, stewards of humanity's best compassions. But
you do not by any means got to hand it to them.
You do not have to hand it to them. Yeah. Like, I think ISIS definitely has much stronger, like, probably, you know, societal foundation than maybe some of the cartels' histories. But for the most part, you've had the Sinaloa cartel region as a region of operation in Western Mexico, which would probably give California law enforcement some sincerely hard times. A lot of the horror stories that you might see out of shows like The Shield that create this propaganda kind of porn,
we should watch
probably had to do with the Sinaloa cartel. So, Cabeza de Vaca working with or controlling the Gulf cartel probably makes him some kind of a good guy to the, you know, Hamilton-loving crowd of California. Because they would like it to just be that easy.
The AIDS love Hamilton. They just love hanging out in dungeons, injecting adrenochrome.
Adrenochrome. Adrenochrome all day. Adrenochrome for days.
Yeah, as I understood, there was some DEA document that one could find that, yeah, that suggests that Sinaloa cartel had some official sanction that some of the goals of the DEA interventions were to
were to favor the Sinaloa cartel. Some of the gun walking stuff was to help the Sinaloa cartel. Definitely we could get into like the filibustero adjacent history of California.
Yeah.
Where the gold rush was essentially, I mean, and then again, like Texas, they got California in the Mexican-American War. And the gold rush was essentially, you know, a movement of these private armed individuals, you know.
Yeah.
So we could get into the gold rush a bit in a future episode.
Cool. Yeah, we should. That's probably big. It seems to me that it's more like the DEA pits the Sinaloa and the Gulf cartels, like non-state actors, against each other, and then tries to rationalize building state actors that are willing to work with them over time throughout those dynamics, which, you know, like, is a valid law enforcement strategy, I suppose, if you've already another group. But what you have in Tamaulipas is this is tied specifically to the petroleum fossil fuel industry, to the point where you've created another state, like a separatist indigenous ambition within a region to separate from the U.S. and Mexico, because they have enough energy resources to be another autonomous region in and of themselves, which is what
here
in America is kind of saw.
Yeah, there's definitely some kind of two-track process of centralization, officialization, where these slave patrols are getting officialized and institutionalized into the modern police with all kind
of... If you can steal a whole region of the planet from the people around you, why don't you? It's kind of the capitalist mentality, I would say, in this situation.
Yeah, and then there's this continued process of secessionism where they want to like secede new bodies to pursue the institutionalization from existing. I mean, you know, the central Mexican government has a lot of imperialist pressure on it from the U.S., but I guess they want to, just like in the, you know, with the Republic of the Rio Grande, they wanted to get it totally under their control.
Right. You see, like that's, yeah, that's my deal with Mormonism too. It just feels like it's a gang within those network of gangs.
Yeah, I think we should go into, I was reading about the Mormons and Manifest Destiny a bit. And I think there's something that we could get into there. With this dude, Jimmy Falun Gong is an expert on. He grew up in the Mormon Church, and he's a deep historian and has a podcast. Maybe we could get him on to talk a bit about the Mormons.
That'd be cool.
That'd be awesome.
That would be awesome. That'd be super awesome. Wow, I didn't know this was a podcast that you intended us to make friends with. I always go the other route of
starting beef.
I only podcast because beefs have been started, and I'm like, okay, that's it. I'm gonna start streaming. But
all right.
Now you want to just stream to like
make friends and influence people.
Yeah, that's very different. That's very different.
That's cool. Yeah, let's talk about this in a business meeting sometime.
That sounds good. So now we got Cabeza de Vaca, who's going to be our number one target. But I think you've laid out the history where this man Balidos on his right comes in, and then you have the U.S. Border Patrol. So the U.S. Border Patrol, ICE, and basically a lot of the Tamaulipas, Texan municipal and state police create a very loose network of a privatized kind of army whose future all is tied to the border as a business that this man Balidos rationalizes.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, definitely. Balido is way up the chain.
Yeah.
He's in the ether. He's in the clouds.
Upgraded floating
history with the haute bourgeoisie through the ether of private property. These guys on the left, they have titles. So this is Balido talking about what a great guy Cabasa. Yeah, so this dude on the left, Border Patrol, Cabeza de Vaca, they're both like, they have government posts. They are not in the rarefied ether of the global elites, where I would say Nelson Balido's up there. Also, it's just, there's no S. That's my fault.
Right. Okay. So, basically, it's been my point. Like, there would always have been a Cabeza de Vaca. Somebody was going to be a governor of Tamaulipas that had to be a point person for the PAN government and the Gulf cartels operations, you know, and try to legitimize the law enforcement operations there. Someone always had to do that. But Balidos is kind of the bag man for a lot of people, the fixer, the person that kind of has to put these situations together and make them into something bigger.
Yeah, it's not exactly how I see it. I mean, I feel like he's fixing, he's getting stuff fixed and stuff. You know, I feel like, yeah, he is a fixer technically, but mm-hmm. I feel like this dude just has a lot of juice and he's doing his own stuff. I mean, you saw like, it's like 15 companies or whatever on his website's little wall of logos. I don't know.
Cool. Okay. So here we have Nelson Balido saying he's speaking about corruption, refusing to ally with the cartels, and is working to build relationships that will help the economic and physical security of both our nations. This bold stand puts him on the wrong side of organized crime. An entrenched political interest in Mexico. He's risking it all.
Yeah, and we mentioned this last time. Nelson Balado has written 4 editorials endorsing Ted Cruz for Fox News.
Right.
And this Cabeza de Vaca guy, we're going to see just how much of how subordinated to the cartel he really is.
Wow. Okay, so here he is with the local law enforcement, Texan Border Patrol.
And some boys, the big boys.
Big boys.
Beefy boys.
Beefy boys.
Yeah, so this is Reynosa is across the border from McAllen.
Hmm.
And so Cabeza de Vaca has dual citizenship. I imagine he grew up in McAllen, it looks like. Maybe he went to high school there. I'm not really sure. His first arrest is in 86 there. And let's check out that mugshot. Never mind. Sorry. The mugshot comes later. So this is the article about all his connections that goes into the connections with the Bribiesca Sahagún children, Vicente Fox's current wife, her children with her ex. They got wrapped up in a Pemex oceanographia scandal, very similar to the Odebrecht one. We'll get into that a little later. But this goes through his connections. A lot of the crimes that this article accuses Cabeza de Vaca of are related to shaking down merchants trying to transit their goods through the border, legal merchants. So in addition to we're going to see some stuff from the El Perez article about his connections, direct connections to the Gulf cartel.
Gotcha. There he is.
Yeah, there he is. The handsome lad looks kind of like a chiller. I kind of see Cabeza de Vaca as a go-getter. Got a friendly face. I mean, I imagine that he's got a dark side too, but kind of a bad boy. I kind of like him. He got arrested for stealing guns out of cars, presumably to sell in Mexico. Then the same exact year he enters college at Houston Baptist University, which was odd to me. We went into this last time, but
He goes from this to this. So what? It's a success story.
Also, I mean, I don't know. I didn't look up what religion Cabeza de Vaca is. I'm assuming he's Catholic. He's going to this evangelical college, and then he's hooked up with Ted Cruz and these. Is Ted Cruz Catholic?
No, they're all that evangelical. There's a whole evangelical movement within, you know, to like get away from like Catholic. It's weird that like a lot of, and I want to get into the spiritual warfare of it all that. Because I feel like Catholics,
angels,
no angels, but like all these other subset Christian groups, Because, you know, I was colonized by a Catholic school. So I just like, that's the root. That, you know, who died and put you in charge? Jesus Christ. Okay, that's pretty good. Like, you know, there's been this spiritual warfare onto Latin America, starting with the Catholic conquest of the indigenous gods and breaking up different tribes and their beliefs, and then creating completely fake indigenous beliefs to confuse and further erase indigenous beliefs, and then using the fake indigenous beliefs that they gave people as like the foundation for devil worshiping laws that they would actually use to then criminalize and subjugate more people further. So this like
get religious them coming and going.
Spiritual, I'm sorry?
You get them coming and going.
Right. So this religious spiritual subjugation has been a specific concerted project within Latin America, within Africa, within Asia. But as it pertains to Latin America, you know, the Catholic Church's history with the indigenous population is really where I like to begin the spiritual foundation and understanding of these political and cultural movements, which is why, you know, we started Media Res with the political revolution, Mexican revolution of 1910, but you got to go even 100, maybe even 200 years before that to really get into like the Spanish colonial writings of like the projects of spiritual conquest onto the indigenous populations. I see the evangelical movements that are coming out of the American South and bleeding all into Texas and, you know, a lot of the Mexican population in Chicago, you know, has turned to Jehovah Witnessing and evangelical religions and Baptist churches because there's this idea that the Mexican population within the United States specifically is malleable for this kind of spiritual conditioning. It's one of the things that kind of really keep me going in this fight, because to your other point about oil and fossil fuel industry in of itself being a warped spirituality is where I feel like we're ultimately trying to combat against. There's this nihilism of spirituality that in my mind is all stems from this filibustero movement of zealots trying to keep slavery going. That kind of zealotry is also what's going to keep the fossil fuel industry sending lobbyists and fanatics, keeping the fossil fuel industry going indefinitely, no matter what it destroys, no matter who it kills, no matter if it ends life in the universe as we know it. That the brainwashing for nihilism is that long and stems that deep.
I'm a spiritual guy, and I learned about God attending Catholic church on Sundays and stuff. You know, I'm kind of cafeteria, in a cafeteria situation. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to start the troubles. Also, you know, I know the Catholic Church has plenty of scandals. There's an ultra right wing faction in the leadership of the Catholic Church.
Hope is dead.
And these evangelicals, though, like you're pointing out, there's some kind of ultra right wing movement of evangelicals to move into Catholic areas.
Yeah.
Try to recruit the people to their beliefs.
Yeah.
I mean, there's atheists like the Freakonomics guy and Steven Pinker and whoever rationalizing the new forms of slavery and exploitation using science. Right.
Yeah.
So, I try to just keep it spiritual, you know, be humble, you know, not judge people for where they're coming from, what their background is, you know.
It's
about the institutions and these sickos in the secret clubs within those institutions, you know, and that's what it's about fundamentally, just trying to expose them
I mean, I take my agnosticism pretty seriously. You know, I have a spiritual foundation. I also prefer to operate on material logic, the way a good communist should. But ultimately, my view is that humanity is wrapped up in these spiritual narratives. At the root of it, political, racial, cultural, It's a spiritual movement that overarches a lot of those movements, just because spirituality is the song, is the narrative, is the story that most drives humanity's actions, in my opinion. But that doesn't necessarily mean that there's answers there for what we do next. I'd like there to be, but so far everyone that's super into religion keeps ending up being people like this. So, like, I don't know, that's very discouraging.
Yeah, I mean, definitely the spiritual side of life is real to me, and just, you know, it definitely has an effect in the world. That's inarguable. Let's check out some more. Is there more Houston Baptist University? Oh yeah. So this guy, you know, he obviously, you might think he turned his life around at HBU, but I explained that it was about helping the candidate Francisco Garcia Cabeza de Vaca with financial resources, and that Mr. Thomas Yarrington had put me in touch with the candidate, and that I would be the liaison between the Gulf Cartel and the candidate Cabeza de Vaca. This is candidate for mayor of Reynosa, his first political job that he got in the 90s, maybe, that for his part, Governor Tomas Yarrington would operate votes in favor of Cabeza de Vaca, and that it was a fact that Cabeza de Vaca obtained the triumph so that once he was a winner, he would be under the orders of Mr. Tomas Yarrington Rubalcaba. And so this dude, he is an informant in some court filings. He gave this testimony that he gave Cabeza de Vaca 500,000, I assume U.S. dollars in cash.
Nice.
That would be less money if it was pesos, but it sounded like it was U.S. dollars. And critically, though, I kind of highlighted this part because it's not just about the cash. It's about the political machine, too. And Tomas Yarrington is kind of giving the machine more resources. He's almost like outsourcing the cash to the cartel, kind of suggesting the cartel is even in it's kind of unclear if they're subordinate to the politicians or, you know, what is their role? It's a bit unclear, but we're going to see some more. So he got 500 grand for his first political job from the cartel. And it says right here, he's under the orders of Mr. Tomas Yarrington Rubalcaba. So,
right. And to clarify, this is the testimony of a witness to the DEA, right? Like the DEA is shaking this guy down for information. He gives this up.
Yeah, he's the snitch. Yeah, he's snitching.
I mean, I think it's just important to also point out in the spirit of fairness that this confession, you know, was given under a type of duress, which, well, we will be exploring a lot more police brutality and other issues. Police make up confessions and stuff all the time. But, you know, as we will see, this is a lead that the DEA has been really reticent to follow.
And so would it be fair to say,
would
it be fair to say Cabeza de Vaca innocent? Is that your opinion, Jose?
I think that in order for our podcast to reach an audience that will navigate information and facts that we are not privy to with missions that we don't share, in order for them to view this as more than just shitposting podcasting, we should try to give Cabeza de Vaca the presumption of innocence as much as possible. But for the most part, Cabeza, we know that he's an agent.
Wrong. We heard it here.
What?
Jose says Cabeza de Vaca did nothing wrong.
I did not say that. Wow. That's exactly the type of editorializing that is going to make our podcast get sued for libel.
I don't think you can sue someone for saying that somebody did nothing wrong.
Okay, you're right. Well, Amy absolutely did do a lot of things wrong, though, so I don't want to be a liar.
That's what's going to get you sued. One of the things that was not wrong to do was to allow a large stadium in Reynosa to be used by Ociel Cardenas Guillen to give out swag on the Dia del Niño. Ya que ustedes son el futuro de nuestro México. Su amigo, Ociel. Hey. So I think the next photo in the slides is OCL in Hannibal Lecter getup. So I guess he shot it out with the Mexican authorities. And so they took him to the U.S. on this plane where he was the only passenger and all the other passengers were soldiers in ski masks. So, like, this is not like a businessman who kind of dipped his toes into the cartel. Also, you know, I'm put it out there. It sounded from the description of this event that the swag was not legit. Like, that they said they gave out 6 bicycles to like a stadium full of people.
Okay.
Was it even a fair lottery? I don't know.
Awful. So Hannibal Lecter, cartel guy, spooky.
This, his large adult son is listed in El Parese's Tamaulipas Mafia article as a local power player.
Neat. Okay.
So talking Tamaulipas Mafia, we basically got into it. It's all about the cross-border traffic.
Yeah.
This is from a situation where some people, there's this thing in the Tamaulipas Mafia article, I guess people come in caravans from Central America to the outlets in Texas, and then they go back with consumer goods like appliances and stuff, TVs, I imagine, and they go in a caravan to not get robbed, but they have to pay a tax, according to the Tamaulipas article, of like $200 each to whoever the powerful parties are. And if they don't pay it, bad stuff happens to you. And it's a combination of hidden figures and the official state apparatus that these unspecified figures go in and retaliate. And then the state apparatus secures the area to control it. You know, so these guys are coming in after a massacre of these caravan folks to just control the area and pretty much cover it up
we saw that in an article, the Shadow War, where it's almost like paramilitary like cartel members massacred a caravan of undocumented workers trying to get into the United States as a kind of deterrence to caravan raiders. And then the state apparatus came and cleaned it up by saying the massacre was between cartel members. So basically the no innocent lives were lost in this kind of mentality.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you hear that in Chicago. What one of the older people was saying, yeah, that, oh, all the murders in our ward are gangbangers killing each other.
Right.
And El Parese is very systematic in picking apart and debunking that myth that, oh, all the victims of cartel violence are cartel people. Like, he points out, like, 1% of the murders in Mexico, like, are armed, right? So, like, the people that they get killed and there's a gun right next to them. Yeah. So that would suggest that a lot of these killings are, like, one-sided. You know, one-sided firefights.
Right.
And there's all these special police units. Like, the whole war on drugs has been this evolution of special police units and special police units. Oh, first we needed federal special police units. Oh, wait, they're all corrupt. Okay, now we need local special police units. And we're going to see some local, in the next picture, it's going to be some of the local Tamaulipas special police units that I think, yeah, so this Hercules unit was killing civilians. And I think if you change around where our pictures are.
Oops, sorry. Yeah, let me change that up.
Yeah. So you can see she is a politician in Tamaulipas El Parese explains who she is in the Tamaulipas Mafia article. But she's wearing the uniform of this new special police unit in this speech. So, I mean, that shows almost like a bizarre level of affinity and subservience to these new special police units. There's been a movement. There's the Marines, the Mexican Marines, the soldiers of the Navy. They killed a bunch of civilians, I think, in northeast Mexico. And there's a movement to get the Marines out of that region. And I think that El Parese might touch on that in the why there are massacres in drug rehabs in Mexico. But so these political figures, special police units, this casino is one of the places where money was laundered.
I think I might have been OCL's large adult son, possibly. But gotta check back in that article. You all should read it. Read El Perese.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next money laundering business is actually a laundromat.
Okay. Let me get there.
Pretty funny. I mean.
Okay. So just washing money.
Vicente Fox has a connection that
just go ahead and try to get us killed, man. Go ahead. Do it.
Rolled up in a carpet, thrown in a dumpster, and set on fire.
That's how I would do it. Yeah. So Vicente Fox has a connection, so we don't have to spend more time on here.
Vicente Fox has a connection through his current wife to her large adult son. I mean, this is just good vibes all around. Walking out of court, free as a bird, with your mom next to you. Got your golden crucifix hanging out with your chest hair.
Yep.
Nice red sunburn.
It's the life.
Sí, son mis amigos y me llevo muy bien con ellos. No lo voy a negar, pero con ellos solo me une una amistad. This is Cabeza de Vaca's words. Yes, they are my friends, and I have a great time with them. I'm not going to deny it, but with them, the only thing that unites us is friendship.
Oh.
So pretty funny way to talk about your criminal associates.
Hmm.
Yeah, don't burn your bridges. It's like, yeah, we would vibe, but that's it. So the Briviesca Sahagún boys got wrapped up in the Oceanografía scandal, which you can get into. Basically, this company was corrupt. They were stealing money from Pemex. And that weakened Pemex enough for Odebrecht to come in and steal more money. And then Pemex got privatized in part due to the advocacy of Cabeza de Vaca, I believe, in his role as a state senator.
And so, this was in the early 2000s, right?
Oceanografía, yeah, I think might have been early 2000s. And then Odebrecht is kind of the same thing. It's not the same at all. Odebrecht was bribing people. Oceanografía was like a piggy bank to steal money out of.
Right. So Oceanografía seems like it was the intro to the liberalization of the energy, which called market of Mexico. And Odebrecht kind of like, as the nail in the coffin, right? It was kind of like a fun strike.
Yeah, well, really that's how you do it. You break the public services, then you privatize them.
So when was Pemex privatized?
I think if you click, the next image is going to be Cabeza de Vaca's statement.
Go ahead.
You go ahead.
My party, the National Action Party, has upheld the principles of free market economics with social responsibility, since we are convinced that it's the most efficient economic system and one that offers the most opportunities for growth in the country and other family and to the families of Mexicans. We believe that monopolies are inefficient by nature and generate, as we have seen time and time again, an endless trail of corruption. Oh wow, yeah, you wouldn't want that. Not in Mexico.
Yeah, the trail of corruption and
right. So I'm gonna Google this.
Why don't you just get up the Shadow War article and get that whole quote up, because I think it'll say when he gave that speech and stuff. If you want, I mean, I can do it too.
So is Pemex even privatized?
I honestly, I think so. Yeah, I think I think that's what shaked out of, let me get Shadow War up and let's plug.
Want to find the quote on there? Because Google says that it's still, like in 2015, that there were still efforts to privatize it.
I don't know. Let's see. I think El Perese will probably have a good explanation.
I don't think El Perese knows what's going on with Citibank or what's going on with, and I think we're trying to figure that out. Like, Pemex getting national, I mean, like, AMLO wants to keep Pemex nationalized or renationalize it, but he also wants to nationalize the whole of the electric grid, basically so that if it switches from fossil fuel to solar panels, that it's still a national operation.
He's a train boy.
What's that?
Is he ready to build trains?
Well, he's got the Mayan train thing going, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Even though environmentalists say that's going to be terrible, but, I mean, he's doing it.
Yeah, I guess the trains, they're no angels.
Yeah, trains are no angels.
So in 2013, Cabeza de Vaca gave that speech about the opportunities, I guess,
like privatized.
Share. Here, let me go on and share this. Okay, so it says, so this bribery, Odebrecht bribery scandal, they bribed the former president of Pemex in 2019, and he's under some indictments. Calderon, Peña Nieto, Luis Videgaray supposedly all got bribes. They said Mexico ended political gridlock. And I guess this was to pursue the privatization or expand the privatization of Pemex.
Yeah, Peña Nieto continued the bonds privatization of Pemex, but he didn't finalize it.
Right. So in a 2013 speech, Cabeza de Vaca said, let's get the shale oil. We need money for Pemex. We estimate that the shale oil exceeds Pemex's current operating capacity. So they want to frack. They want to get foreign investment for fracking.
Gotcha.
I imagine it is it's probably pretty complicated to what extent it is privatized. Like, it doesn't make, like, if you were one of these villains, you wouldn't want to be like, okay, let's officially privatize. You'd be like, let's functionally privatize and keep a veneer of public ownership so we can confuse people and like fact check them and tell them that, you think Pemex is privatized? Actually, it's still a public company. That's the majority by the government. So
Pemex, I mean, that's kind of where they're at now. It seems like Pemex is still considered a state-owned operation. Technically, the Secretary of Energy of Mexico is the main operator of Pemex. Which I think, you know, we want to, and I want to get into Citibank's investments and this kind of energy restructuring stuff, because they just pulled out of commercial banking in Mexico. Right. And Citibank, that's our boys. That's who put Obama in the White House. That's who got the bailouts, but didn't give us public option. Those are the guys that
are Henry Kissinger, the OG Henry Kissinger, his U.S.-Mexico Chamber of Commerce, prominent members, Citibank, Banamex.
Wow. So we got to look into Citibank's connection with Banamex, because I'm guessing that the liberalization of getting foreign investments into the energy sector of Mexico was not something that they didn't have their fingertips in. But if they're completely pulling out now, or is that their complete focus? I don't know. What's their deal? They don't want to build Mexican small businesses, that's for sure.
It seems like that would be great. I think maybe we should like, for our next research episode, we should research Citibank and banking and Mexico and Pemex. Yeah. That might be good.
I do want to pull up this article before we keep going, but I like this. Police and military death squads, limpieza social, the U.S. trained the newest special operations police team from Tamaulipas.
So these big trucks, these little people in these big trucks, they are kidnapping Mexicans, generally speaking, poor Mexicans. They're killing them. They're dressing them up like soldiers or cartel members and claiming there's a shootout with the cartel. And
that's great part, right?
There's a lot of very graphic images in the El Paresi article. I think we chose not to include them here. But if you go over the El Paresi article, you'll see the soldiers' uniforms that they dressed up people in. And it's not just the poor Mexicans. There's Mexican Americans who've been killed, people who were doing some kind of cross-border small business and for some reason pissed off the cartel. Yeah, this dude, he says in an interview, I'll pay you, and then we're going to publish it in English regarding images that have been shared on WhatsApp and stuff and Telegram. That is often images taken by the police doing these false flags themselves. And this dude's like, we're going to pay. I mean, I'm not going to characterize that he's paying for false flags. I'm saying he said he's going to pay citizen journalists. And according to El Paresi, a lot of the time those citizen journalists are actually the cops themselves doing the false flags and dressing these people up.
Right. So what you call it here, you see them training, right?
Yeah. So we talked a lot about these cops being the henchmen of schemes such as shaking down people shopping at outlets right across the border. And they're going to get more training. They're going to get more intelligence support. We haven't even touched on the fusion centers. What a fusion, you know, probably some of our audience, they've never heard of a fusion center. I've heard of them as just this general, it's like a room with the cops, the FBI, NSA, even. They're sharing all this intelligence. They've got all these computers hooked up with Ethernet cables. And they do stuff like the NSA, there's a big scandal that they were providing intelligence on like low-level drug dealers to the DEA and then telling the DEA, you have to come up with a parallel construction for how this you got this information, so you didn't get it from us. So there's all kind of shady stuff going on in these fusion centers. The actual intelligence might even be more important than like the guns and trucks, but they are getting big trucks. So they're wrestling. Here's, look at this guy in a cowboy hat, the PowerPoint presentation.
All right. Before we keep going, can I read this article from the Citibank situation?
Yeah, sure. No problem. Go for it.
What you call it? Sorry. Let me just because I think that especially because this comes from our boy, Michael Bloomberg. You know, he's got his home political publication here.
Oh yeah, he didn't write this article though.
No, he didn't write it, but he has people write what the hell he thinks. He's not interested in what other people think. City's exit triggers damage control in crisis scarred Mexico. Finance minister, banking head rush to ease savers worries Mexico economy has nothing to do with city's decision. Ramirez. Okay, what is going on here? Citigroup's incorporated plan to exit retail banking operations in Mexico has pushed the government into damage control mode to ease concerns in a country scarred by a financial crisis in the 1990s. Oh-ho, remember that? That's why you had to pass NAFTA. Finance Minister Rogelio Ramirez de la O sought to tamp down any negative reading on the economy from the potential sale, and he said the government would seek to limit the closure of any branches. He wanted to send a message to account holders, to savers, that they can be confident that there won't be a loss of assets, Ramirez told Bloomberg News on Wednesday. Banamex, or Banco Nacional de Mexico, was formed back in 1884 and is the country's number two bank when it was bought by Citi in mid-2001 amid a wave of acquisitions by foreign players of local banks that were devastated by the 1994-1995 tequila crisis. Hey, The Rock is making a new tequila, isn't he? Many Mexicans remember the bank failures that hit the country during the crisis. Some took to Twitter to comment on Citi's exit and wondered about the future of their savings and pensions. The head of the country's banking association, ABM, appeared on several top local media programs to tell Citi Banamex clients that there was no reason to panic, whoever ends up taking control. Daniel Becker Feldman, ABM's president, told Bloomberg News on Thursday that there had been no signs of clients pulling money from Citi Banamex branches. The relevance of a brand of as iconic as Banamex has generated speculation that does not obey reality, he said. All Citi Banamex users should be absolutely calm. This should not generate speculation about what may happen. These types of transactions happen all over the world.
It's pretty suspicious.
Yep.
Everything's trying to get people to speculate.
Everything's fine. Everything's, don't worry. Don't panic. Everything's normal. Opponents.
There's no reason to go to the bank and request your money.
No. Opponents of
President. Run to the bank. Run away from the bank.
Opponents of President Andrés Manuel López Obrador said Citi's moves is the latest sign in his signs his nationalist policies are scaring off investors. Yeah, because if a Chinese bank ended up buying them, everything would totally be fine for liberalism. But no, maybe not. His nationalist policies are scaring off investors. Even though Citi's plans fits with the bank's global strategy of exiting offshore consumer operations, it follows moves by UBS Group AG to close its Mexican brokerage and JP Morgan Chase & Company to shutter its local wealth businesses. American capitalists shutting down in Mexico. That's never good. López Obrador appeared in a video message on Thursday as he recovered from his second bout with COVID. Damn it, dude. Where he said he met with ministers about the Citi Banamex sale and emphasized how he hopes the bank is bought by local investors like billionaires Ricardo Salinas Pliego or Carlos Slim. You know, totally non-shady guys. Ramirez de la O, the finance minister, said the bank's decision to exit isn't related to the country's economy or its future, as some local media suggested, pointing to the fact that Citi will continue investing in Mexico, including building a new tower for its corporate banking headquarters. Yeah, they're just waiting out that government. Third base. Yeah.
I mean, so what? Yeah, I'm kind of like.
We're almost through this.
What is your interpretation of this article? Or do you want to read the rest of it?
Yeah, let me finish this off. Third biggest, Citi Banamex saw its market share whittled to 12.9% of deposits from 22% in 2001. And now the country's third biggest deposit-taking bank and is now the country's third biggest deposit-taking bank. CNBV data shows. In the aftermath of the tequila crisis, Mexico's banking sector became highly concentrated in the hands of mostly foreign-owned banks like Spain's Banco Bilbao, Vizcaya, Argentaria S.A. and Banco Santander S.A., as well as HSBC Holdings, PLC, and the Bank of Nova Scotia. Wow, Canada. Ramirez de la O told Bloomberg he would seek to make any sale does not break antitrust rules in the industry. To me, so there's a couple of things. It's very obvious that López Obrador is not someone that the Western media or elite is interested in boosting or helping his transformation project of Mexico whatsoever. He's holding on to power because he's played a very deft game within Mexican politics that I think has a time limit on it. The DEA will probably end up charging López Obrador's government for cartel crimes and drug dealing operations because all the governments have been guilty of this. And
why do you think the DEA is going to charge AMLO's government with drug dealing?
Just some BS I see on Twitter from AMLO's opponents. But my view is that there's a discrediting of him trying to maintain it, the energy grid under national control. Under the pushback is going to be that he's helping the fossil fuel industry worldwide stay alive when really having national control and allowing the government to siphon off investments from that infrastructure into green infrastructure is probably the only way to radically transform an energy grid away from fossil fuels in a country that primarily relies on fossil fuel sales for its sovereignty. But the way I interpret what's going on with Citibank is that what we're seeing here is basically Cabeza de Vaca and the PAN party spearhead an operation to liberalize energy in Mexico. And then the government of Peña Nieto, and because he couldn't stop this process because the politics were conducive to being a willing player, has continued the bond policies in order to further legitimize this kind of democracy between bond and PRI. Now López Obrador is tasked with going after the bond players that liberalized the energy sector to show that it was based off of personal corruption and not for the good of all of the Mexican people. But that has a three-year limit before the next election, in which Peña Nieto, which has been pretty quiet, can offset anything that happened under his administration onto López Obrador with the assistance of the American banking world that has been doing business with the PRI way before they came up with this plan to take basically the fracking.
So you think fossil that the fuel banks are trying to retaliate against AMLO?
I'm sorry?
You think the banks are trying to retaliate against AMLO for AMLO's Mexican nationalist agenda with the with the typical social progressivism that's always accompanied Mexican nationalism?
I think, yeah.
Well, these banks are run by sickos. Do you mind if I jump in and share?
Go ahead.
Let's look at some of these sickos. This guy, this man with the what's the thing that the incels think, like your jaw is weak and so you're not attractive?
I don't know.
This guy has it. He is running. He Turtle did. Jaw? He ran Citibank. James Stillman Rockefeller.
Dude.
This dude. Nelson Rockefeller. Nelson Rockefeller. No, David Rockefeller. This guy, slightly less weak jaw. But the chin, something going on with his chin. He seems uncomfortable. He kind of looks like the awkward dude from Peep Show. Yeah. He did Chase Bank, which I'm going to go ahead and speculate is the next level up. And okay. This guy, this Silver Fox, Lawrence Rockefeller, has the most occult connections of the Rockefeller children. This guy, very strong jawline, looks kind of like, I don't know, like a bit more confident.
Yeah.
He's running the investment bank, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. And I'm going to leave Nelson Rockefeller out of it for the minute. But you know, these people are sick, and I wouldn't put it past them to try to sabotage the Mexican economy because they got a guy like AMLO in there trying to shake things up, you know?
Yeah, which, you know, like ostensibly a Morena fan over here, but just because I think it's a necessary movement in Mexico, and I'm hoping that people caught up in it rationalize the immediate history of Mexico with the next century. So that's the hope behind all this stuff for me. And I do think
you gotta look. Well, do you want to talk about the banks more? Because I think we should do a banking episode, like banking in Latin America and, banking and imperialism, you know?
There's one more article I kind of want to share.
Okay, why don't you show it? Yeah, bring it up. Yeah, let's talk
about it's the same thing. It's just but I did want to compare Bloomberg.
I gotta plug in my laptop. Yeah, but go ahead and start presenting.
Sure. So Bloomberg kind of, you know, I feel has a very self-interest globally in itself, bless you, and processes to keep enriching and empowering itself, especially along municipalities. Reuters is just kind of more bare bones, deep state. Like, here's the facts, Jack. Citigroup.
Reuters is a wire service, right?
Yeah. Well, exit, it's Citibanamex. So they have a couple names here. Citigroup's decision to sell or spin off Citibanamex, Mexico's third biggest bank by assets as of June, is part of Chief Executive Jane Fraser's strategy to bring Citigroup's profitability and share price performance in line with its peers. I mean, I think that's fair. Like, Citigroup bought Banamex when it was the second most powerful bank in Mexico. Now it's fallen to third. Was that Banamex's fault? Is that Citigroup's fault? You know what? Let's split. See what's going on. After taking up the job last year, Fraser pledged to simplify Citigroup by exiting non-core businesses, including consumer franchises in 13 markets in Asia, Europe, and Middle East and Africa. While Citigroup's Mexican exit was not part of the announced plan, it is consistent with the strategy refresh. Citigroup will retain its institutional client business in Mexico as it has in other overseas markets. It will focus its consumer banking business on a targeted U.S. retail presence, global wealth management, and payments and lending, it said. Basically, they don't want to deal with the small business owners of Mexico. They don't want to deal with regional, businesses. They want to deal with establishment oligarchs and aristocrats of Mexico only. So AMLO's move to say, hey, richest people in Mexico, do you guys want to own a bank? Is probably the best move for him, since those are players that will still be working with Citibank.
Yeah, so I actually saw AMLO speak in Chicago at a public event at a high school. And, they were talking about, like, there's a lot of manufacturing in Mexico, and the U.S. is not going to be able to make invisible blockade like they do in a lot of their coups of smaller Latin American countries. So I kind of think that, yeah, this is pretty much what you're talking about. Like, they're just trying to mess with the small depositors, small businesses, consumers. Seems primarily like the goal could be a combination of the fact that they would like to shake up the Mexican economy, make it scream, although it doesn't know, I don't know if that's going to necessarily make it scream, but mess with these depositors, small depositors. And like you said, they'd rather work with the big oligarchs. I don't really know if working with the oligarchs is going to help AMLO. Maybe it will. I hope it does, if that's what he does. But it seems like overall that might backfire in general. But you know, in the general principles of scientific theory of socialist revolution, that collaborating with the oligarchs generally backfires. But doesn't mean it has to this time. It might work out for him.
Work for us. You know, this never works. You know, people delude themselves into thinking it will.
Monorail.
Isn't
going to be anything like Shelbyville's monorail.
I mean, look, my whole point, though, too, in bringing this up is just that this history that we're unpacking here of Latin America has been a foreign capital, foreign investors, people that have no regard for the human life of the regions, basically coming in and setting the rules of this is the way it's going to be on this land. And I think we have to look at AMLO and Morena's situation in Mexico as a cultural revolution, because that's all he's really trying to do. His hands are tied by moves like this, with the ultimate prize being the energy grid staying nationalized in order to have a rational region country in Mexico. And I think that America hits AMLO and a lot of the liberal European world hits Mexico as this fossil fuel governed narco state. And they're using, like, hey, we need to get off fossil fuels, and your whole narco state government is basically run by the fossil fuel industry. You know, we're within our existential rights and needs to basically wage war on your infrastructure, and then buy it up and take it over after we make our point.
Sounds a bit like the Gilets Jaunes situation. You know, France talking about, oh, we got to make these provincial truck drivers pay more for gasoline to stop global warming. And, you know, yeah, it seems like, you know, AMLO developing the the economy of Mexico is not a bad thing. I guess they I don't think they should expand fracking. Hopefully they don't.
Yeah, hopefully they don't. But is it Pemex that wants to expand fracking or other oil companies that want to pay Pemex to be allowed to frack?
Cabeza de Vaca says Pemex can't frack, that they need
They need
foreign investment. Americano money.
Right. And so, I mean, so we see how hard it is for Mexico to be its own rationalized region. Like, you know, you have these banking cartels kind of making moves to kind of like shake up the population. And then within the Texas operation of security that's just focused on a border that they make into a business, this narco terror label that kind of becomes about from the Breitbart News, which call it narrative building on bullshit, is a way to blanketly wholesale criminalize all the individuals in the region as bad actors, and further kind of wash any state crimes to maintain control.
Yeah, yeah, that's you go back to the last slide to show the Twitter thread. So I think that this press conference is Balido in the lower right, Cabeza de Vaca in the upper left. They're talking about restarting Se Busca Información, which is like a top 10 wanted people for the cross-border region. So again, like if you, I mean, I think that is pretty clear. These Tamaulipas cops are largely corrupt. Even if you come at it from an imperialist perspective, it doesn't seem like giving a bunch more resources to corrupt cops for intelligence and surveillance is going to help them be less corrupt. It seems like it's going to help them in their machinations, having this intel from the north.
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah, and this was one of the people killed that El Parese put in his article. Jennifer Romero is, I think, U.S. citizen, Mexican-American, pregnant and killed by the state/mafia nexus related to one of these civilian massacres and dressing up her and her family and friends as cartel soldiers, which we did not include those photos, but they are in the El Parese article if you want to see.
Yeah, and I think that's the end of the slides, huh?
Yeah, yeah. So I don't know. Yeah, I guess we could have a little debrief about it, you know. Heavy stuff.
Yeah. So we didn't really get into the whole Florida state private army building. We've seen, we need to, you know, like make our steps a little bit clearer to people. But the regional security apparatuses of Texas and Tamaulipas revolve around the history of which call it basically racial supremacy and control and tied directly to the fossil fuel industry as kind of like the lead geopolitical and necessary which call it for energy consumption industry that would make a region almost completely autonomous from any outside control or influence. It's in my opinion that Florida, see in any region, but sees those dynamics and tries to replicate them to be its own. I mean, which is the whole project of the United States to begin with, of these states being kind of their own principled regional actors that have to come together and come up with federal rules for themselves. But I don't know. Did we want to get into Florida? Did we want to get into private army stuff?
If you have some stuff prepared to present about it, that would be cool. I would like to maybe do a future episode about like counterinsurgency in Florida, possibly modern counterinsurgency. We talked about doing a Seminole Wars episode for sure. That would be nice. That would be cool. But I think, you know, there's Liberty City uprisings and the very aggressive police response to that in the 80s during the Reagan era. You know, you got the cocaine cowboys in Miami, the right wing Cuban training camps. I think I was reading Program to Kill the other night. Shout out to Jimmy Falun Gong for introducing me to that. It's a chill podcast, Program to Chill. They were talking about, like, possibly there was some, yeah, oh, this was the Atlanta child murders, the Wayne Williams, who was eventually convicted and alleged to have committed the child murders, but only convicted for adult murders. He supposedly, as a child, attended a training camp that was in the Georgia, right across the border from Florida, for the right-wing Cuban exiles to do the Bay of Pigs. And this training camp kept going. It was called The Farm. These training camps were all over Florida and Louisiana and stuff. Definitely when we went over the filibustero, it was the first the first filibustero movement right in 1812 when the U.S. was still fighting with the British. They started the movement to annex Florida, and it didn't complete until well after the Civil War because of the Seminole resistance. So there's a lot going on in Florida. I like to unpack Florida fully, you know, and I like to do that in a future episode. But I think that if you have some stuff you want to talk about, Ron DeSantis and the private army, I don't have a problem with that. Yeah, maybe we could put 3 hours is the upper limit, you know, wrap up at 3 hours and we can just cover this, whatever you want to cover for the next 40 minutes or so, if you have, or however long it takes, you know.
Sure. I do think the Seminole Wars of Florida pretty much is the foundation of what's so wrong with its politics, its history. And as you mentioned in our, you know, kind of like prelude episode, you know, it was kind of the what preceded the Civil War and its politics. The Haitian Revolution basically also like creating a lot of the fear in the American South about the Seminole Nation. And again, I mean, racial supremacy being the driving force of like Andrew Jackson's politics of the time and the secessionist politics.
Sure, nice.
Yeah. But I wanted to we talked about this guy's defense of the DeSantis's private army. We found a lot of holes in it. I kind of just wanted to bring up what's his name, Brennan. Brennan Center guy. What's his name?
I don't know if I've seen this article before.
Yeah.
The governor sounds similar. Joseph Nunn.
Okay. Well, that's so, get thee to a nunnery.
Pedo mustache.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oof. Yeah. What you call it?
No allegations alleged. Just describing the mustache. Don't sue me.
Wow. It's pretty harsh, but
So they started the state defense force in Florida, which is going to be non-federalizable. So currently there's 200 volunteers. There's actually, I think this is like building on some I was Googling around. I found some legislation from the early 2000s kind of describing how the state force, state National Guard would work. So it's going to be, they're only going to get paid when they're activated is one issue. There's, I guess this says there's going to be 200 people, 3.5 million. And, clearly the state police and the local police do counterinsurgency activities. The Florida National Guard does counterinsurgency activities, not to the extreme extent that some of these local politicians ask for. Obviously, they're unwilling to risk the integrity of the whole system to crush a local insurgency the way that these Southerners want them to.
Yikes. I mean, the state operation, it seems like it being free from federal direction, you create a kind of personalized, defense policy for your region. And then even though this is a force of 200, you know, not the state guard, that, you know, has thousands of people in it. So the Florida National Guard has 12,000 people in it. 12,000 military personnel employs an additional 450 civilians. That receives $454 million. DeSantis is looking for $3.5 million to have 200 volunteers train and equip them to basically be his state ops. And so this guy is basically saying he's not creating an army large enough to take over the nation. But if you create a sizable, well enough funded force, like we see in Tamaulipas, like we see in Texas, you can have a state operation that basically guides the narrative, the physicality of how you're wrangling civilians, that leads to federal policy for law enforcement. So the way that law enforcement can create any kind of reality in a region, if it has control over, its media, its mass information, and basically everything that we've seen that Florida has that makes it like not the best state for COVID and things like that. Giving a privatized state operation the reins over the direction of security policy, especially in a region like Florida that has a lot of influence over the Caribbean and South American politics, you are creating the national policy for security from the ground up. You know, Chicago's seen that impact. New York has seen that impact with the broken window laws and the stop and frisk. California sees that impact, the three strike laws, Florida is trying to create that kind of state regional autonomy and formalize it into security policy, in my opinion, is what DeSantis is doing. And we have to just look at what Tamaulipas and Texas are able to do with the fossil fuel industry and the border as big business to see the dangers of allowing such state operations to lead federal security policy when it's not in the best interest of the people in any of the regions that they're overseeing.
All right. I mean, I have my own speculation about the goals of the Florida State Guard. I want to save that to the end.
Okay.
Do you want to go through some more of this article or anything not like really. That?
That's kind of it. What do you think?
All right. Just gonna share my whole screen here. Hopefully I don't have my personal email open or anything. You know what? Let's just do the tab. Let's look through this website. Florida State Guard Reactivation Group. So the original Florida State Guard was during World War II. It was like the National Guard got mobilized for World War II. So they created this State Guard and to guard the homeland. And this is also what they did with the Civil Air Patrol. The Civil Air Patrol was a body that was the civilians would fly aircraft around the border of the United States to kind of patrol the border there. And as we all know, Lee Harvey Oswald was part of the Civil Air Patrol in New Orleans. The Barry Seal, the drug trafficker, was part of the Civil Air Patrol and supposedly flew arms to both sides of the Cuban Revolution. Let's check out Barry Seal here. So my speculation is that here we go. Yeah, this is the photo. Barry Seal.
Oof.
This is him with all the right-wing Cubans at Jack Ruby's nightclub.
Okay, right? Wow.
So Lee Harvey Oswald was in the Civil Air Patrol. David Ferry was a Civil Air Patrol counselor who abused the young boys who were part of the Civil Air Patrol.
Why?
They don't have enough pictures.
Are you showing more pictures? I'm just like stuck on your Google.
Oh, wait, are you not? Did I get
I see the photo from them in the nightclub.
Oh, I accidentally opened another tab. Sorry. David Ferry was in the Civil Air Patrol. So we're going to, yeah, here we go. This is a weird looking guy. He's played by, this is Joe Pesci playing him in the JFK movie.
Sorry, I'm still looking at the Tom Cruise tab that you shared.
Sorry. I don't know why I'm so off. Off.
You're good, man. You're good.
David Ferry.
You have COVID too?
I had it, beat it. I'm hoping not to get it again. So yeah. Played by Joe Pesci in the JFK movie. One of the things, like, he had really bad fake eyebrows, supposedly. He got arrested for the child abuse charges, and then he somehow finagled to have the cops who arrested him arrested.
Ooh, that's slick.
So this is what I'm thinking. We're going to do right now a psychological forensic examination of the Florida State Guard website to find signs of a hidden MKUltra program for recruiting and brainwashing oddballs.
Sure. I mean, just drug them and make them do weird things. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Get them. They get to, you know, join, get Tiger all the King toys. Figured that out.
Yeah.
Tiger King.
He figured how to do that. Just like Special K all day. I'll go for it.
What is an SDF?
SDF. I don't know.
This appears to be a lot of stuff from the, that Brennan Center article. And here are the possible SDF missions. Since the Florida SDF is not yet a reality, once it is established, we expect its many missions will be closely aligned with emergency management / disaster response. Floridians helping Floridians. Manpower. Since the Florida SDF is not yet a reality, once it is established, we expect its many missions, blah, blah, medical and nursing personnel, public safety / security. So this guy, Jose, are you still there?
I'm still hearing you, yeah.
Okay, this we are homing in on a forensic psychological situation. This is trying to get people with authoritarian personalities and who are susceptible to hypnosis to join this organization, to wear uniforms, and to get brainwashed into the future assassins. Like, I'm seeing, like, a lot of uncomfortable awkward, not self-confident volunteers in these photos, possibly staged photos of the force.
Are these? I don't want to interrupt you. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Sorry, one interruption really quick, and I'll let you keep going. Hey, please, the go whole ahead. History of hazing from those creepy slave-driving colleges, military colleges,
yeah,
that would make a lot of people feel, like, unsure and uncomfortable with themselves and being malleable to be brainwashed, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't really want to go into all that when we were because with the Citadel, but yeah, definitely, like, the hazing follows the pattern of what was going on with the Civil Air Patrol. So this thing, this Florida State Defense Force does not yet exist. The website is well constructed in terms of organization, but the text has not been proofread.
Okay.
They repeat paragraphs multiple times. They say, since the Florida SDF is not yet a reality, multiple times on this page. I'm not sure if these photos are of future SDF volunteers, but they seem to be susceptible to brainwashing. I think the goal is going to be to continue the MKUltra techniques, develop assassins, mind-controlled assassins for future decades.
Okay. So that's what you think the Santos is up to in Florida? Like
200? That's my speculation on the Florida Guard. I don't think that it's innocuous. Yeah. I think it's really weird. Yeah. But I'm not sure if it's activated yet.
No. Well, I mean, like, but yeah, I mean, like, I feel like we're saying the same thing, though. Like, you know, he's creating a specialized group of ops to steer the regional security operation. And I mean, yeah, you're going to have to brainwash those people or have them already be malleably brainwashed into what you're trying to get them to do, for sure. You know, and there's a whole history that in the region that they've already created to have this kind of slave catching culture that they can tap into and then the whole seminal war of it all is an ongoing reality, I think, for South Carolina and Florida and Georgia. I mean, that's white land. That's the have you been in those areas?
You said earlier Florida is not the best state. There's a lot of messed up stuff going on in Florida.
All over the South.
I guess Chapo covered this Prius driver who got in a shootout with a local Republican.
Saw that.
And won. Pretty cool, yeah. I guess.
Prius drivers that open, like that conceal carry for good purpose in Florida. That's just the kind of hellhole it is. Like, oh my God.
I guess you got to hand it to them.
You maybe that one. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You ready? You want to talk some more Florida State Guard?
I mean, we could, but I think that devoting an entire episode to it is probably the wiser move. You know, I think that we really want to unpack the history of Tamaulipas, in terms of crime and security and politics, because it's a region that's going to have a lot of attention and misinformation about it. But appreciating the history that made us arrive to this point, I think is the best way to, for people at home, that are going to be caught up in the waves of these, of narratives. And forces moving in self-interest, it's the best way for them to make sense of all the moves that are being played by the, you know, centers of gravity in the region and how to best keep themselves from being bought into wholesale violence or the chopping block for that violence. I mean, that's always the concern, I think, for the masses, is you don't want to be caught in the wave of massacres. And there's a portion of humanity that also wishes not to participate in those massacres, if they have any say in it. So that's what we're here doing, what we're doing. But that's all I got for today.
Okay, sure. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I think maybe we should have a little biz meeting after this, talk over, debrief, and maybe even make a list of some of the future episodes we want to do.
Cool. You know, last... episode, we did three topics, right? We did Tamaulipas, the Filibusteros, and the Mexican Revolution. So, you know, we were going to try to do this twice a week. I think that once a week is much more manageable for our schedules. So this is our week two episode. Two. Next week, we will be revisiting one of the topics that we already talked about, because we don't have to make new slides. And we just get to talk about those slides for 2 to 3 hours, you know, instead of the hour that we did. And, I'm not sure which one we'll be talking about, but it just seems like the Filibusteros is most pertinent to this. So we might go backwards to Filibusteros next week and then end the month with the Mexican Revolution so that we open up to new topics in February.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Let's talk about it. That's what we talked about. Sounds good.
Okay.
Let's get on Zoom and sign off here. So this is OAS Information Service telling you, good night and good luck.
Adios.